wonderful. It's wonderful, you know, and I'm excited about what I want to share today. You know, everyone who is present here today, this message is for you. This message is for you, but it's about prayer. It's about the bodies, about the spirit, soul, and body. It's about prayer. That's why there are not many. Not only the church is much more bigger than this. More people come. You know, I don't want to name the people who are not here, but the devil does not want you to know about this. I can guarantee you that. The devil does not want you to know what I'm about to share. And this series on prayer is so very important because it's the key to a successful life. It's a key to an abundant life. It's a key to financial breakthroughs. It's a key to a healthy life. It's a key to protection. So the devil doesn't want you to have this key. He doesn't mind you have all those others, you know. Joy, you speak about joy. You speak about a parable. You speak about prosperity. A lot of people come. But you speak about the power of prayer. Then even if they want to come, there's something will happen. The son will be sick. A tire will go flat. The engine will have a problem. So listen carefully. Listen carefully to what is shared. It may be a little hard, but it's worth going through. If you understand what's being shared, it will change the way you pray. You will begin to pray regularly, effectively. It will also change your way of life. You will begin to live successfully. You will become more than a conqueror. You will become an overcomer. Everything that is being shared, I may not say this is how you should pray, but what I'm sharing has a bearing on prayer. I want you to know that. If you understand, you can pray effectively. But this is only the first step. What I'm sharing today actually is a first step. It's a component. It's just part of what makes prayer effective. Who is God? You must know that. Everybody says God, 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 God. But who is God? Then who is God to you? That's so important. If you do not know that, then your prayers will not be effective. You will be praying to the Creator. And the Creator reacts differently. But if you pray to Abba, Father, He reacts differently. So it depends on who's God to you. Then you got to know who you are. You got to know who you are. Because if you don't know who you are, then you won't know how you're praying. Whether you're praying in the flesh, whether you're praying soulish prayers, or whether you're praying in the spirit. You got to know what is the purpose and the role of the spirit, the soul, and body. If you don't know the role, then you're just praying and hoping, tikam, you know. I hope I hit something and it's lucky. I got to know the purpose I am on earth. Why am I here on earth? Why do I pray? Do I pray God's will to be done? But what is God's will? Is His will to do 1, 2, 3, 4? Then I can pray effectively. What if I pray outside His will? I got to know that. Then I got to know what is praying in the spirit. I got to know why is faith so important in prayer? Is faith a major component in prayer? Without faith, can I pray in the spirit and get what I want? Are there powers fighting against me when I pray? Is there powers that stop my prayer from coming through? Is there spiritual powers that prevent the prayers from being answered? If there is, then I want to know, how do I overcome these powers? How do I overcome these problems? Are there obstacles that prevent my prayer from being heard by God? There are powers that prevent the prayers from being answered. Are there obstacles in my life that prevents the prayer from going up to God? So all these things are in the scriptures. And you need to understand them. So I'm just sharing one part of it. So maybe a bit technical, but it is so important. And God wants you to know this. But each time I start sharing, you know, I wanted to share today about the power of the body. Why it's so important to have a body in earth. But God sends a direction another way. So I know He wants to share this with you, okay? I know in all my heart He wants you to know this. But let me do a quick recap before we get into the meat of today's message. First is, what is prayer? What is prayer? We dealt with that in part 1 and 2. What people say about prayer, we went through that. But I want to remind you what John Wesley said about prayer. He says, God does nothing but by prayer and everything with it. That's a very strong statement to make. Jim Stanley quotes Tony Evans. He says, prayer is giving permission to heaven to interfere in the affairs of earth. So according to John Wesley, Tony Evans, Jim Stanley, Miles Monroe, and many other preachers, God will do nothing if you don't pray. So the question I pose to you is, who is waiting for whom? You say you're waiting for God to act. You say you're waiting for God for a breakthrough. You're waiting on God. God come through. But who is waiting on whom? That's the question you got to ask. I suggest to you, God is waiting on you. God is waiting on you to pray, because he will do nothing until you pray. And that's in scripture. So important to pray. That's why he tries to prevent everybody from praying. That's why the devil doesn't want you to pray. The devil doesn't want you to pray. But praying intelligently, praying according to what God says, will bring you everything you desire. Let me tell you, will bring you everything. We think that we only must pray all the holy things. No, I want to assure you, you can pray for things that are very earthly, very earthly. And God will give you if you are in alignment, if you understand why he doesn't give and why he gives. If you understand that, you will get it. Like the brother today, he understood, came early, said, God, I am prepared to pray for this place. I am prepared to be faithful. All the keys are there. I am prepared to be joyful. I am prepared to do your work. You want me to teach, but I don't know how. Lord, I need an amp. And doesn't the Lord provide? At exact price, huh? That's the price of the amp that he's getting. That is God. He answers even before the service. And God will do the same for you. But then you got to ask yourself, did I act like how he acted? Did I follow the precept? You got to ask yourself that. If you walk, say, in 40 degrees this way and 10 degrees that way and 20 degrees later and you got wet. So if you want to get wet by water, you want to be drenched, you got to walk in the same, go 40 degrees, 20 degrees, 10 degrees. Don't say, no, I want to get wet, but I'm walking this way. I want to get wet, but I'm walking that way. You got to follow the pattern of the person who is blessed. Then you may hit it. Or you got to understand why he's being blessed. Because he walked this way, it's the open heaven. And he's receiving it. All right? So try to understand as we go through. Prayer is most misunderstood, but most important. I think you know that. I don't want to emphasize that. People misunderstand its application. You know, I mentioned this thing and I want to mention it again. Prayer is like, you know, somebody tells you, this is the way to cross the road. You go to the end. You don't cross in the middle. Because if you cross in the middle, somebody's going to knock you. Very simple. So you go to the end. So you're very happy. Now I know how to pray. I go to the end and I pray. But the minute he mentioned the zebra crossing, they're all confused. How come the fella goes shortcut zebra crossing? Because that's an exception. You can cross the zebra. Then you mentioned the traffic lights, he gets more confused. So I thought you said go end of the road. You said this. Then you mentioned the bridge, he gets more confused. And I'm going to mention traffic lights. And I'm going to mention bridges in prayers. Listen carefully and you begin to listen. I mean, begin to understand. But do not misapply it. Do not misapply it. Because a lot of people, they understand a certain facet and they go and apply it. And then, why is it not happening? Like this guy. This guy says, you know, he says, you know, God, I believe that you're going to come through for me. I believe if I pray, I'm a man of faith, you will come through. And I told the whole village. And there was a flood. There was a flood. And he said, God's going to come through for me. And the village said, okay. And the water began to rise and cover until the roof of the building. And they said, listen, we sent you a boat. Send a boat to him. Come away, come away. And he said, don't worry, the villagers. My God will save me. My God will save me. I will pray. I know how to pray. I will pray and he will save me. And then the boat went. Then the next boat, last boat, this is going up to the roof. I mean, the pinnacle of the roof. That means the highest point. And he's standing on it. And they send another boat, last rescue boat, because the storm is getting, the water is rising. And they say, listen, come on. Come on board. We give him a name. Mr. X, come on board. Because he can be you or anybody else. Mr. X, come on board. And he says, hello. I have faith. And God said, if I have faith, like a mustard seed, I can say to this mountain, be thou removed. I have faith and I am praying to the living God, Jehovah. I know you can call him Abba, Father, he's praying. And the water keeps going up and the boat left. And now he's at his neck. And there's a helicopter now, no boats can come. A helicopter is coming and they let down a ladder. And it said, Mr. X, can be you or anybody else. Grab hold of this ladder. It will save you. No, I am praying. I believe when I pray, God hears me. I ask God to save me. And I'm waiting for God to save me. And he drowned. He drowned. And he marches into heaven because he goes there. He says, St. Peter is there. Move away. I need to talk to God. I'm upset. I prayed. The Bible says if I pray, God will answer. And he runs up to St. Peter, passes St. Peter, goes to God. God, God, he says, you know, how could you do this? How could you let me down? I trusted in you. I believed. I read your word. I had faith. And God told him, you know, I sent you two boats and one helicopter. What else do you want me to do? Two boats and one helicopter. He understood the concept of prayer. He knew God will ask him, but he didn't recognize when God answered. He knew God will answer his prayer, but he did not recognize when God answered his prayer. Many of us are in that situation. We ask God, give me humility. The minute somebody waxes, oh, how come that fellow is getting angry with me? Oh, I got tortured. I got a problem. You know? We ask God, give me richness. Give me finance. The minute we get some discipline, oh, I don't. Why am I being disciplined? There is a secret. When you ask for help, God will send. When you pray, God will answer. But you got to recognize what God and how God is answering. So important. So important. Huh? You must know when to use what. You must understand his application. Another joke. Okay, another joke. This young priest just taking over a parish, comes into the parish and takes over the parish. And there's Mrs. Kelly is his house maid, the one who helps out in maintaining the parish. And he comes to the priest and he says, tells the priest, your roof is leaking. You know the pews in your chapel? Those pews are creaking and needs to be repaired. And you know your issue is going on. And the priest said, Mrs. Kelly, I'm trying to be inclusive. Let the church be everybody's. Let's all be inclusive. So he says, Mrs. Kelly, why did you say our roof? You know, our chapel, the thing. And it's you because I'm just here for a few days. You've been here for 5 to 10 years serving. So it's more yours than mine. You know, so inclusive, so nice. So he said, oh, thank you, Mrs. Kelly said. And she goes on. 2 days or 3 days later, the bishop comes. So the bishop comes and he's looking at the priest and watching how he's managed, because new priest. And he brings two other senior priests to advise and they have a meeting. And as they're having a meeting in the conference room, Mrs. Kelly bursts in, you know, and say, Father, tells the young priest, there's a mouse in our room and it's under our bed. So the bishop gives him a look. Wrong application. See, the principle is right. Wrong application. Don't know when to apply what. Sometimes we are like that. Oftentimes we hear a truth. We don't know how to apply it. So it's my job today to try to help you see how to apply it. Okay? That's the job. So the first thing for you to recognize is God keeps these things a secret. That's what I shared last time when you hear it. He says, these are secrets of the kingdom, hidden from those people, but revealed to you. So there are secrets of a kingdom. There are secrets revealed to you. So we are revealing secrets here. So you must get a secret. The other people don't understand. Other people who hear this may not understand, but you must understand it's secrets of the kingdom given to you, not them. You must understand. All right? First thing you've got to understand is, we're talking about a kingdom. What's a kingdom? Because we live in a democracy. Some live in a Republic of India. You know, we live in a place where the people rule. I want to tell you very quickly the difference between a kingdom and a country. Because when God is speaking to you, when Jesus is speaking, he's speaking to you about kingdom principles. Kingdom principles. We are understanding kingdom is our country. A kingdom has a king. You got to know that. It doesn't have a president. A kingdom, a king, dictates what to do and what not to do. In a democracy, the people decide through parliament what is right and what is wrong. In a kingdom, the king decides. Very clearly, the king is the king. Nobody decides he's to be king or not. He's not elected. There is no voting. He's king. In a democracy, you are elected. You only get by popular vote. You got to win the popularity of the people. In a kingdom, the king doesn't need to win. He or she is king or queen by virtue of being king and queen. Inherent. That's a kingdom. So you got to understand when God speaks to you principles, he's talking about a kingdom. He's not talking about a country. He's talking about a kingdom. You know, that he makes the laws. He tells you what's right and what is wrong. Anybody else can say whatever they want. It doesn't apply in his kingdom. What Jesus says applies. What Tom, Dick and Harry says doesn't. And a lot of Tom, Dick and Harry claims to represent him and says a lot of things based on the country that they live in, based on what they understand. But they do not speak of the kingdom of God. And a lot of preaching is about Jesus. If you hear, it's always Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. But what did Jesus come to preach? He came to preach about the kingdom of God. And this gospel is about the kingdom of God. The principles of the kingdom of God. That's what he came. The good news is about the kingdom of God. But we always preach Jesus, Jesus, and we stop full stop with Jesus. I want you to understand the kingdom is different from a country. The kingdom has its own culture. The kingdom has its own culture. The kingdom has its own influence. You know, a kingdom has a crown, a scepter, and the incense. He carries that around. That's the king. The scepter is the authority. The crown symbolizes power. So the authority is given to you. All authority now is given to you. Go ye to all the world. But he is the king. But you are his authority. That's why when you pray, his will be done, his will be done. That's why you carry the authority. Now the kingdom has its own culture, I said, you know. It's got its own what's right. You know why we all like to eat tea? And we like to have tea in a cup. We have to have cup, British better. You know, we have to have style. And we have to have 3 times a day or 7 times a day. Because the queen drinks tea. And we belonged at one time to a kingdom. So Malaysians should understand a kingdom. The king is everything. And we follow a certain culture. The kingdom, the queen and king may be far away. But the culture exists in this country. So you may be living in Great Britain. The king may be there. But we are practicing what is being practiced in Great Britain. It is the same with the kingdom of God. What is being done in heaven is being done on earth. Your will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. Same culture. That's a kingdom. That's a kingdom. The kingdom believes in commonwealth. Have you heard of the commonwealth? We belong to a commonwealth. The wealth is common. Nobody owns property. All property belongs to the king. So you give. If your brother needs a shoe, give. If your brother needs a shirt, you give. Because it belongs to the king. It's not yours. It's not yours. That's a kingdom. That's kingdom principle. So do you get the picture? Jesus was sharing to you the secrets of the kingdom. You belong to a kingdom. When you pray, you pray like how they pray in the kingdom and things will begin to happen. That's why he says the kingdom of God has come. The kingdom of God has come and the government shall be on his shoulders. You see, God is bringing a new kingdom, a new hierarchy, a new authority and he's giving it to you. It is not like what's in the world. So you got to have a kingdom mindset. Remember, you got to have, every time you pray, it has to be a kingdom mindset. I cannot dwell too much. There's so much to share there. There's so much to share there. But in this kingdom, nobody worries. You cannot worry in this kingdom. You cannot have anxiety. In this kingdom, the culture is love, peace, security, power, and authority. Whatever you say, it is done. Nobody in this world can stand against anybody from the kingdom. Nobody. Because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. That's why you can say to this mountain, they will obey, because you carry the authority of the kingdom that you belong to. Which kingdom do you belong to? The kingdom on earth or the one in heaven? That's why Jesus said, this kingdom is not of mine. If it were, my angels would stand up. This is the kingdom of the world. It belongs to the devil and his demons. But we belong to the kingdom of God. And the kingdom of God has come. So no fear, no anxiety. You got to have love. You got to have love, peace, joy, kindness, faithfulness. Those are the fruits of the kingdom. When you begin to exhibit these things, you are functioning on kingdom principles. You are in the kingdom. So you see, anybody exhibiting this, you begin to check. Are they practicing the kingdom principles? The secret is this. In this kingdom, there are only two major laws. Two major laws. You follow these two, you keep all. Love thy Lord, thy God, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. And love your neighbor as yourself. On this hang all the laws of the prophets of this kingdom. The ambassadors of this kingdom that have spoken through the scriptures have told you that this kingdom, because so many laws I'm confused, but I say follow these two and you fulfill the culture and the rules of the kingdom. So bear those two things in mind. Understanding how God works and ourselves, understanding God and ourselves is a key, is key to successful prayer, is key to successful prayer. God is spirit and you are spirit in a soul, in a body. So you've got to understand that in his kingdom, everybody's a spirit. They use all kind of bodies. So you have one with a face of a lion. You have one with a face of an ox. You read it all in Revelation, Ezekiel, you get shocked. Because it doesn't matter what body you use. Because you're a spirit. So you can use any body. It doesn't matter what color your body is. It doesn't matter how fat, how short, how small. Because it's the spirit that belongs to this kingdom. It is your spirit. So you are spirit and you're in a soul, which is in a body. So you got to recognize that. You got to recognize that. Okay? Understanding God, how he works. Understanding God's culture. Understanding what this world is all about. Understanding what you and other humans are. Why you are here. All helps you pray effectively. Live effectively, live abundantly and successfully. You cannot belong to a kingdom and live like the world. It's a contradiction in terms. You say, I belong to the kingdom, but I live. The enemy will come after you because he can see that you belong to the kingdom. And he wants you to live under the influence of the world. We got to be careful. So the secret is not to worry. The secret is, you know, doing what is right. Let me put it this way. If you worry, it'll create fear. And what does fear create? Insecurity. What does insecurity create? I don't trust anybody. And what does that do? Loneliness. What does that do? Keeps you away from God. You know, a child grows in an environment of fear, anxiety, insecurity. Does he develop into a good child? Does he maximize his potential? No, he doesn't. He becomes bitter, angry. He loses his temper at the wrong time. He does things. He cannot control himself. He malfunctions. He malfunctions. So there is chaos. There is confusion. There is pain in his life, anxiety and hate. The environment that this kingdom gives is love, gentleness, kindness, patience, long-suffering, self-control. This kingdom teaches his people to help the poor, to minister to the destitute, to protect the widows. So you will find that kingdom principle working this way. The Good Samaritan, it's a kingdom principle. The kingdom of God is like this. A man who goes on a far country and finds. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed planted. The kingdom of God is always Jesus teaching the kingdom of God. So recognize that you are in a kingdom. In a kingdom. So you are spirit and you're in a soul, in a body. The three parts work together. What you do in the body affects the soul and spirit. What you feel, think in the soul affects the body and spirit. What you declare from the spirit affects your soul and body. Okay, I want to do again the same example I did the last time. Because when I asked, what ministered to you? And they said, you know, when you showed the three people in front, oh, I can remember that. So can I invite three people to come forward? again. Yeah, three people that came last week. Come. Since you want to be body, soul, and spirit, who's that? Mm. Come. Okay. Okay, soul, spirit. This is the spirit, the soul, and the body. Okay, hold it, your hands. All right, last week he said, hold, Jaden, you got to hold the hands. Good. Okay. Okay. So when the body goes forward, what happens? Everybody goes forward. When the body decides to go down, everybody goes down. So when the body stands up, everybody stands up. Get this in your heart. Huh? This is so important. What the body sees, turn and see where you want to see. Can you see the board there? All turn and see. What the body takes into her ears, all go into their ears. Do you understand what happens? So, who controls the body? Who decides where the body goes? The soul decides. He is the final arbiter because he controls the body. He decides where the body sees, what the body sees, how the body sees. Okay? Just sit down. I'll call you up again in a few minutes. Okay? Where the body sees what. So, you got that picture. The spirit gets what he gets through the body. It learns through the body. The soul gets what it gets through the body. So if the spirit wants to read the Bible and the soul decides no, can the spirit read the Bible? Cannot. If the spirit wants to hear the word of God and the soul says no, and the body says, I'm too lazy. Say the soul also says, yes, this time you're lucky, two-thirds. The body says, no, I don't want. I am tired. Can you hear or not? Can you read the Bible? Can you hear the word of God? Unless the soul overrides the body and says, listen, you listen to the word of God, regardless how tired you are. You come to church on time. You're overcoming the body. So the body fights. And the body starts to retaliate. The body starts to make your eyes hurt. Gives you a headache. Makes you hungry suddenly. The body's got its own tactics to make you do the thing. But the spirit needs the body in order to receive from God. He needs to hear the word of God. Remember, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing the word of God. He needs to hear it. But if you don't come to church, can the spirit come to church? If the body decides not to come, or the soul decides not to come, can the spirit come? So I hope I emphasize enough. They're all interconnected. So you cannot say, I don't want to have anything to do with the body. You know, I just want to live in the spirit. I don't have to do anything. So cannot. All three are one. They're interconnected. So important to recognize this. Okay? Man is spirit being with a soul and a body, and in a body. Yeah? The spirit gives life. Without it, you die. It is the spirit that gives life to the body. You saw, right? The spirit was small, and you have the body, and you have the soul in between. When you move the body, when Philip moves away from the spirit, it dies. The body dies instantly. So when you separate the body from the spirit and the soul, it dies. So the body in itself has no life. It is dead. It is dust. It goes back to the ground. But the soul and the spirit remain. They exist. Because when they are connected, suddenly the body comes alive. It's like the power bank, the battery. So if your soul and your spirit is sick, what happens to your body? The body gets sick. It's just common sense. Because you take out the body from the spirit, the body dies completely. The source of the power is here. So the body is a reflection of what's in the spirit and in the soul. Your body begins to reflect it. That's why the Bible says, he who is wise, his face shines. The Bible says, the eye is the mirror of the soul. So you can see the person's soul through the eyes. So you know now the interconnection. So important, all three to be together. So when you speak from the spirit, you give life, because God's word carries life. You understand? God says that. I shared with you last week. There is life in the word of God. There is life. So when you speak, you are speaking life. That's why the Bible says life is in the power of the tongue, life and death. You speak the word of God. If you speak from the spirit, you're giving life, because that's where the power source is. And your words carry that power to your neighbor, to your neighbor. So when David played and sang those songs, even the demons flee. That's why you can tell a demon, get out. It is your voice that is saying it, and your spirit chases it out. Because that voice carries power. What power? The power that keeps the body alive. The power in your voice. So important for us to recognize that. That you have power in your words. You have life. So when David played, when David sang, even Saul could be at ease because the spirits couldn't disturb Saul. The demons were put to the side. So you have power. You have power. And when you speak words, you've heard people say, after speaking to you, I feel my soul is lifted. How can a soul be lifted by words? Because words carry power. I feel joy has come into my heart. I have hope. In the old days before battle, in any community, they would call for the orators to come. And the orators will share. You have seen so many movies, in fact. You have seen battles that take place. And then you will hear, for example, King Theoden riding up to his, and they are facing these hordes. And he will start speaking to his men. We will fight to the end. We will defend the helpless. And suddenly courage begins to build. Their spirits begin to grow. They are so powerful. So your words have tremendous power. In prayer and in declaration. Don't forget, there's power in prayer. Even in prayer, your words have so much of power. And in declaration. So when you declare, things begin to happen. Man is made in three parts. You know very well, is interconnected and locked in together. Get this. What you do with either one affects the rest. It's not only one way, it's both ways. But the ultimate decision maker is the soul. Can I have you three again here? The ultimate decision maker is the soul. Okay? Now, you have the three. The minute I kill the body dies. This doesn't exist. There's only soul and spirit, and they go to be with God. So the body is nothing without the soul and the spirit. Do you get that? You are spirit. When I say you are spirit, this is what made the soul. The soul carries three things, you know, the mind, the emotion, and the will. What's the mind? It's your intellect. It's your memories. It's your thoughts. That is the mind. What is the emotion? You know, whatever you feel, right? Sad, angry, hungry, whatever the emotion that you feel. And what's the will? The ability to decide what you want to do. So the soul is something that God loves very, very much. God is the spirit. He gave you the spirit, yes. But he loves the soul because the soul distinguishes you from chichao. Yoga soul is different from kid's soul. But the spirit may be the same. Love, caring. Your spirit, you may recognize each other. But the soul is the distinguishing factor. And it's your memories that make you up. It's what you do on earth through the body. What you experience on earth through the body or through the spirit that makes you who you are. If I take it all away, you're nobody. You don't know who you are. So this whole experience on earth is to make fantastic memories. To learn and become and know who you are. Because you're going to be the same person in heaven. You're going to be Keith Ganesan in heaven. You're going to be Yogendran in heaven. So these memories you're going to take with you, whatever you do on earth. So you got to remember that. So the body is here, you have the soul and the spirit. The body is hungry. What happens? Tells the soul, I'm hungry. So you feel pain, you feel hunger. Can you decide to eat later? Can the soul decide to eat later? Who makes the decision? Soul makes the decision. So soul tells the body, hang on, I got a meeting, I'll eat afterwards. We have all done that. But the body says, I'm hungry, I need to eat, I need gastric juices coming out. But the soul says, hang on. Okay? So the soul is the decider. Then he says, we will eat at 6 o'clock. Now, the body says, I like KFC. Who decides where they're going to eat? The soul decides, we're eating at home today. Because don't want to waste food in the house. Have you done that? We've done that. The soul decides. Though the body is saying, I'm craving for KFC. I want KFC. But the soul decides. Sometimes we are told not to lose weight. So we say we don't want to eat lunch. I've seen my son say, I don't want to eat rice. But the body says, I want to eat rice. But his soul says, nope. no rice, and he doesn't eat rice. But there are times where the body says, listen, I want rice and I don't care, and the soul better listen to me. And the soul listens. And the soul listens and he eats the rice. So the body has got certain powers that the soul gives it. If the soul decides, nope, no power, then the body will comply with your wishes. So fasting and praying brings the body into subjection. It reorganizes your life. Sometimes the body gets carried away. The body says, I want to see these things. It satisfies my hunger. And the soul has got to decide whether or not it allows it. The soul has got to make that decision. So in Ezekiel chapter 18 verse 20, the Bible says, the soul that sins will die. The soul that sins, not the forefathers, not your forefathers or what comes after you, but the one who decides will be the one who is ultimately responsible. And the one who's deciding is actually the soul. Now, the spirit tells the soul, shall we read the Bible? How's the soul going to do it? The soul has got to connect with the body, body, turn right, and read the Bible. Then only you can read the Bible. But the soul has got to decide to listen to the spirit. If the soul chooses, no, excuse me, I'm tired, leave me, keep quiet, the spirit will keep quiet. And the soul then will decide to do whatever he wants. So now the soul has got to decide who he wants to follow. Joshua asked me, does the soul and the spirit, does the spirit and the body have a will? Because I said the soul has a will. The answer is yes. The will of the body is to do whatever satisfies the flesh. The will of the spirit is to do whatever satisfies the spirit. And the will of the soul is to decide which one he wants. Whether he wants to walk in the flesh or he wants to walk in the spirit. So he's got to decide. And that's what God wants you to decide. So how do you get to do the right decisions? By renewing your mind with the word of God. So the mind makes the decisions, right? How does the soul decide to make? Can you just stand here? I hope you're learning. Learning. Okay. I'll read you a few things. The soul decides what to eat. Now, if you feel thirsty, you got to drink. How do you drink? You get the body to act. If you feel silly, you feel stupid, you feel, I do not know what to do. The soul says, we got to learn and put things into my head. How do you do that? How do you read the book that you want to read? The soul must tell the body, let's read. Let's read. The soul then decides what to read, what to hear. Now, if you feel angry, you feel angry because somebody insulted you. Somebody told, I think you're a very stupid person. Is the body affected? Not at all. The body is very beautiful. The soul now is hurt inside. The soul now wants to whack and slap and kill him. How does he do it? Can he come out and whack? Cannot. He'll take the body and whack him, which shows you that the soul is in complete control. It can whack the person and kill the other person because it got offended. The soul got offended. So you know by just deduction that the soul is in complete control. Now the soul feels a bit jealous. Somebody is so rich. So the soul says, we got to steal some money to become rich. Tell the body, can you now cover yourself slowly? We'll go and do this. Again, the soul takes control of the body. You know, soul taking control of the body. If you feel guilty, you're a sinner. Somebody tells you, you are lost. You are a failure. You do wrong things. What does the soul feel? Leave me alone. I want to go. Come, body. We don't go near the church. We don't go and pray. We stay far away. We stay by ourselves. We don't go and mix with Christians because we feel like a dirty sinner. The soul decides for the body and for the spirit. The soul is in control. But how does the soul decide? How does Keith, being the soul here, how does he come to his decisions? I want to tell you how you decide. When I feel depressed, I want to kill my body. When the soul feels depressed, he wants to kill the body. I want to end it all. And he thinks by killing the body, by committing suicide, I end it all. Who kills the body? The soul. He decides to end it all. I've had it enough. When he feels depressed, lonely, and upset. When the soul feels love, what does he do? When the soul feels I'm loved, he becomes happy. He wants to bless others. He wants to minister. He wants to dance. He tells the body, come on, let's dance. Let's go to the backyard and celebrate. The soul wants to celebrate. Let's go to Waikiki and have a good time. We want to dance. So when the soul feels, it begins to decide. So it seems that the soul makes a lot of decisions based on feeling, based on how it feels. And that's why Jesus says it's so important to love God. Love is a feeling. They say love is a decision. Yes, that's spiritual love. There's a spiritual love which is deeper than the love of the soul. I shared that last week, right? The soulmate, you love physical, soulish. But there's a spirit love. God says you must love God with all your heart, which is your spirit, with all your mind, which is your soul, and with all your body, which is your body. You got to love with all three. And your neighbor as yourself. Self is soul. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. You don't want to insult. You don't want to get hurt. You don't want this. Love your neighbor the same way you love yourself. So love is an important feeling to have for the soul to decide correctly. Correctly. Get this. How does emotions work? Now you know. Feeling is the one that dictates what you do. How does emotion work? How do you get to feel what you feel? That's the question. How do you get to feel what you feel? Answer is here. It's a combination of what goes into your mind and what you keep meditating on will determine how you will feel to react or act. A combination of what goes into your mind and what you meditate on. Now, Sigmund Freud puts it this way when he speaks about the soul. There is the id, there is the ego, and there is the superconscious. Makes that distinction, you know, the three parts in there. So the mind, will, and emotion. Now, Miles Monroe puts it this way. You can't prevent anything from coming into your mind. You know, you go anywhere, people say, hey, bloody this, or whatever, and all that. You read the papers, all that. But you can't prevent yourself from meditating on it. He says, God is so good all through this parallel. Okay, take a seat. I know you guys are tired. Thanks so much. God is beautiful all through this parallel. So what God does is, in everything that has been created, He teaches you about Himself. In everything that is being created, now He's teaching you about Himself. So don't think anything new created, oh, it's different. It's same. So the example now fits very well. RAM and hard disk. You know what's RAM? We all know computer language. Random access memory. Where you have a memory for a short time. Once it goes, it goes. Once you're off the computer, take it off, it's gone. But hard disk, you maintain what you have gone in, right? You save in the hard disk. Right, Jaden? You save in the hard disk. So what goes into your mind, and you wash it clean with the Word of God, it's gone. But when you meditate and you start thinking about it, you start harboring it in your mind, it gets into the hard disk. It gets into your heart. So when somebody offends you, you get angry, let it go. Say, God, okay, I forgive him, I'm gone. But if you keep thinking, how could he do that to me? You know, it's way too much. I gave him so much of faith. You start meditating. It starts downloading into your hard disk. And your hard disk, you cannot do anything. How do you erase your hard disk? You practically have to bring in another program to erase your hard disk. You can't simply erase your hard disk. It's always there. You've got to get another program, get another hard disk. Very difficult. So the new program, of course, is the love of Jesus Christ. It's the blood of Christ that changes it. But you've got to recognize that you must not meditate on things that are not good. If you meditate on bitterness, you meditate on envy, on jealousy, you meditate on things that are not of God, it will download into your hard drive. It will create feelings. And feelings then will control the body and there will be action. That's why the spirit wants to take you elsewhere. Spirit said, don't worry about it, Keith. Don't worry about it, Philly. Don't worry. Let's think on good things. Let's look at good things, you know. So keep, Paul says, think on good things, I put here. You know, the Bible says, Paul says, always think on good things, things that edify, things that encourage, things that build. Because he wants you to put that into your hard drive. The psalmist David says what? Meditate on the law of God. Why? Because he wants you to download that. So that you will control your body and the spirit in the way that it ministers to yourself, to the soul, and to God. God is doing all this for your benefit, no? We always think we're doing it for His benefit. Actually, He's doing it for your benefit. It is well with my soul. You're not talking about the spirit. It is well with my soul. You're sick in the soul. Very important for you to understand that point. Immanuel Kant, I put here, born in 1724, one of the leading philosophers, or should I say, Age of Enlightenment leaders who shaped the country's, the world's idea of what is right and what's wrong. His arguments were the distinction between experience and pure reason. Immanuel Kant. By the way, he was a Christian. His name was Emmanuel, E-M-M-A-N-U-A-L. He studied Hebrew to study the Word of God, and he changed his name to I-M-M, Emmanuel, because he understood that that was the name that was given in Scriptures. So Immanuel Kant was somebody who studied the Word of God thoroughly. He came from a very religious family. He was German. And then the argument was this: we are creatures of our environment. We are creatures of our environment. Whatever happens in our environment affects us. So we are no longer responsible. So if I am born a thief, if I'm born among thieves, and they're all stealing and doing all kinds of things, and if I steal, then I shouldn't be punished because I'm a creature of my environment. So if I'm in a world that everybody shoots and kills and does everything wrong, then I also shouldn't be punished because I'm in that environment. Immanuel Kant said, no, man lives apart from that. There is a part of man that is stronger. There is a part of man that has what's called the will, that can decide from right and wrong. He has the ability to reason that which is good and that which is bad. And that is the ultimate thing that decides whether he kills the person or not, not his environment. And therefore, you can judge a man and sentence him to death for killing another individual. You may take into account his environment to consider mitigating factors, to consider that he may be provoked or whatever. But yet he is responsible when he pulls the trigger. He is responsible when he stabs the person. And based on that, you will find that all laws in the country requires a man to be responsible. He can say all kinds of things. I had no money, so I killed the person. I did this. And all. End of the day, the law says, listen, you are guilty if you intended to do the act that you did. Because the intention comes from the will, and the soul has the ability to control the body. So you see, the philosophy, how is it? And it's a long scripture again. The soul decides. The soul decides. But how does the soul decide? The way you feel. How do you begin to feel? By what you meditate on and what you think. Same thing. How does everything start off with? A thought. The thought, if you think long enough, becomes a habit. Or creates a desire first. First the desire, the feeling, the excitement. And the desire you have long enough causes the action. Just you take the action. After the action, you repeat, becomes a habit. The habit forms your character, and your character determines your destiny. So you can see the pattern, but it's coming back in this way. God is again presenting it, because we shared this earlier. He's presenting it again. He's telling us, think on good things. Think on things that edify, encourage, build, exhort. In Romans chapter 12, verse 2, he says this: do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So it's so important. The mind. You must protect the mind. In Ephesians 4:23 it says, and be renewed in the spirit of your minds. Again, the mind. The Bible says put on the helmet of. Why? Protect the mind. Salvation is an important point. Because if the devil gets you to doubt your salvation, he has won the battle. So he says put on the helmet of. Protect the mind. Philippians 4:6-7, what does he say? Be anxious about nothing. Do not be anxious about anything. There is no qualification, everything. But in everything, sorry, double emphasis. Be anxious about nothing, but in everything, to make sure that you cover both. By prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, happy heart, let your request be known to God. And the peace of God, important to have peace, that surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and mind in Christ Jesus. Guard your minds. You got to guard your mind in order to ensure that God's things are done in your life. The Bible also says, rise up above all, take the shield of faith with which you shall be able to quench the fiery darts of the enemy. That's how the enemy attacks you, through your mind. Through your mind. Did God say you should not eat of this food? Did God say you shouldn't touch? Did God say this? Didn't God say you are the Son of God? If you jump down, the angels will give you. Are you truly the Son of God? That's how he challenges you. He challenges you in the mind. He challenges you in the soul. In Colossians chapter 3, verse 2, it says, set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. Set your mind. And that's in the soul. Set your mind. So you know that you have to guard and protect your mind. But the body is world conscious. The body is conscious of all your surroundings. Is conscious of the world. I'm hungry, I need to eat. The soul is self. That's where pride is. That's where pride is. It's in the soul. How could you do this to me? Who do you think you are? All that is the pride, you know. And the spirit is God conscious. God conscious. You are a spirit being in a soul, in a body. What the body does affects the spirit. Question, does the spirit grow? Does it eat? Does the spirit have a will? I answered that, it has. Can the spirit die? Can the spirit leave the body? What does it mean to be born again? When you say born again, what am I trying to say? Now before I go there, I want to tell you this. The Bible is very clear. The flesh is world conscious. The spirit is God conscious. And there's this constant struggle between the two. So the flesh says, I want to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The spirit says, let's do 1, 2, 3. Let's do 7, 8, 9, 10. And you have to decide. And you will find that in all of us, there's that struggle. All the time, there's that struggle. It's when the body comes in line with the spirit and the soul. Oh, you become such a powerful. You can walk on water. Not an issue, because the body now is functioning like the spirit. You can say to the mountain, be thou removed, it'll be removed. When everything comes and becomes congruent. But when there's a battle going inside, when you are fighting inside, then God comes to help you. God comes to set you free from the captivities of the flesh. The flesh takes you into captivity. God comes to set you free. Remember that. So, the battle is going on. It's up to you to decide whether you want to follow the spirit or the soul. But what does it mean to be born again? I'm going to ask Yvonne to read what it means, what Jesus said about being born again. These are the words of Jesus Christ himself.
John chapter 3. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that you do except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say to you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it listeth, wills, and you hear the sound, but cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. So is every one that is born of the Spirit. Verily, verily, I say unto you, we speak that we do know and testify that we have seen, and you receive not our witness. If I have told you of earthly things and you believe not, how shall you believe if I tell you of heavenly things?
That's the words of Jesus Christ himself. You see, the proof that Jesus was from God, according to Nicodemus at least, and the Pharisees, how did they determine that Jesus was from God? Very simple. The miracles that you do tells us that you are from God. You cannot do these miracles except God be with you. So it's miracles that declare that that person is with God. Jesus reads, and Nicodemus knows this, got people from the dead to rise, the deaf to hear, the blind to see. He turned water to wine. He fed thousands with just two fishes and five loaves. He calmed the storm. He even got a fish to give a gold coin. You know that, to pay the taxes. Very simple. It is by miracles that Nicodemus said, I know you are from God. Now I want you to turn your Bibles, if you have them, to Mark 16, verse 16 to 18. Mark 16. I want you to see what Jesus said there. And I read, he who has believed and has been baptized shall be saved. But he who has disbelieved shall be condemned. These signs will accompany those who have believed. In my name they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will pick up serpents. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. These signs will follow those that believe. Very simple. This kingdom, the ambassadors of this kingdom that we are talking about today, have the power to heal. When they lay hands on the sick will recover. When they drink anything poisonous, it will not harm them. So you wonder, a lot of people, what, a fellow ate the apple and he got this mad cow disease, or he ate this beef he got, but another fellow ate, didn't get the mad cow disease. How come? We don't understand that in this kingdom, you don't get it because Jesus, you belong to this kingdom and these things cannot affect you. You get healed. You get restored. If you pick up serpents, it will not harm you. You speak in new tongues. You know, this is what happens to those that believe. Okay? Then Jesus declares a truth and you must let the truth digest. Jesus declares this truth. He says this, unless you be born again, you cannot, what, enter or see? You cannot see the kingdom of God. Some versions say you cannot enter the kingdom of God. You cannot enter the kingdom. You cannot see. That means you are blind to the kingdom of God. So before you came, you were born again. You couldn't see. You couldn't understand. You couldn't enter the kingdom of God. That's why you wonder, hey, the fellow did so many good things. Huh? He's not being saved. The answer is he cannot. If he's not born again, he's not going. He can use the name of Jesus. He can claim to be a Christian, but he cannot see the kingdom of God. He cannot see the truths in the kingdom of God. So no matter how good you are, no matter what your friend does or whatever he does, if he's not born again, and that is so important, to be born again. But what does it mean to be born again in order to see, in order to enter the kingdom of God? What does it mean to be born again? Nicodemus said, you know, God, does it mean I have to enter into my mother's womb a second time? I want you to know this, that all truth is parallel. You know that. What is born of flesh is flesh. What is born of spirit is spirit. I'm not saying that. Jesus is saying, I tell you things about heaven and you do not understand. I mean, about earth. How can I tell you about heavenly things? I'm teaching you about things now here on earth and you don't. And I'm a witness, Jesus is saying. I'm telling you the truth. What is born of flesh is flesh. So you see a child coming out, a baby. And what is born of spirit is spirit. A spirit coming out, a baby. So if you want to know whether a spirit needs to grow, the answer I'm suggesting to you, I'm not declaring, is yes. A spirit needs to grow because you have to be born. You are born just like how the flesh, the spirit has to be born. And it means, you know, a new spirit comes into you. That means something happens at the point in time where you're born again. A spirit gets into you. And there's a spirit living inside. A new spirit. Not the old spirit. You know, like some people say, oh, now my spirit is reunited with God. No, no, no. It's a new spirit. It's a spirit that God is giving you. And then you become very powerful because now you are known, you have become the sons and daughters of the living God because you have this spirit. So you can be in church, but you may not be born again. You can pretend, you can say everything, but you may not be born again. You can still practice and use Jesus' name. Yes, it will work because his name has authority. But are you born again? Do you have that spirit living in you? Is that spirit growing? And is that spirit living, growing? Now listen. When a baby is born, what must you do? You got to feed it milk, right? When a spirit is born, you got to feed it milk. Spiritual milk. You cannot feed it the hard things we are sharing today. The spirit cannot take it. He get confused and say, I don't understand what's happening. But as the spirit matures, they say, he's got a mature spirit. He's got a mature spirit. That's what they say. So as the boy grows, as the child grows, he grows up, he learns things, he learns. And you do not expect him to behave like a child. That's why you find your relationship with God changes as you grow up in the spirit. When you were first born again, everything you ask God. God, I like this. God, I want a pencil. God, I want a bike. Got it. God, I want a shirt. Got it. God, I want a handphone. Got it. Got everything. Then later on, God says, no, you cannot have this. Suddenly you find you're getting into a lot of difficulty. Suddenly you find you're going through the school of hard knocks. You know, Moses, when he grew up, very happy. Eventually, when he got into trouble, when he was older, 40 years old, he had to leave and go into the desert. Similar pattern. Because God wants to train you. So you find as a spirit, as the spirit is born, you will find your life. Most Christians, you can check. I know for my life, it's a fact. When I was born again, I got everything I asked for. Today, when I ask, God will check me. Ask for money, he says, why do you need it? I say, I want to give more. God says, show me what you did with what you have. So it's very strict. But when I was young, I asked, God gave me. I remember I lost my wallet in a taxi. You know, I asked God, I want my wallet back because you can do power. You are powerful. Who sends back a wallet? Because my IC is in it. A few things is in it. You know? And I said, I don't worry about the money anyway. Only $3 was in the wallet. So no big deal. I don't worry about the money, but I need my wallet back. And amazing, 4 or 5 days later, so it comes through the post. The fella bought a postal and you got to buy a big postal stamp because it's quite heavy. And the wallet is intact with my IC, with everything else except the $3. But God sends it back. God sends it back. Because you're a baby, you're praying, and God hears you. Now God expects more. Because now you're an adult. I expect more from Jaden at this age than I did when he was a baby. And I'll expect more when he's an adult. So that is the same thing that happens in the spirit. The flesh takes 9 months to conceive. Sometimes it takes a long time for somebody to be convinced that Jesus is Lord and to believe in him. It takes some time before they become born again. So you've got to pray and you've got to pursue that. The flesh doesn't know much, and has to grow up, had to be fed. The spirit is the same. Now, what is the food of the spirit? What does the food that the spirit need? You know, you got to give the flesh milk. If you don't give a baby milk, what happens? Baby dies. If you don't give the baby some love and kindness, what happens? Do you know that they said there's an experiment done where they said that if you don't touch the baby dies. If you don't touch and hug, the baby dies. It just languishes and dies. You know, because he feels nobody loves him. But the love has got nothing to do with the body. Love is a feeling that takes place in the soul. But the baby still dies, you know. Even though the body is fed, milk is put, everything is put, still dies. So your soul needs to be nourished with love. So what is the food of the spirit? The Bible has told you, I am the bread of life. Jesus is the food of the spirit. The word was with God and the word was made flesh. Who was made flesh? Jesus. So when you eat the word of God, you're eating life into your system. So hearing the word, meditating on the word will bring you life. And that life more abundantly. That's what you got. That's why God says, listen to the word of God. Grow in the word of God. The Bible says it over and over again. When you are a child, you need protection, right? Can you defend yourself? If another big fella comes to harm you? Cannot. The child cannot. The baby cannot defend itself. When you're a spirit, you also need protection. You need that. You need divine. And God sends a guardian angel. All of us have a guardian angel. I declare to you that, because it's every preacher man comes, shares that. Every great man shares that. Everybody's assigned a guardian angel. And at the assignment, according to one of the great preacher men, which I believe, he says, the assignment, the angels, you have one guardian angel assigned to you. And that guardian angel's job is only you. And after you die, his job on earth is over. He's there from beginning to end, from the time you're born. In fact, from the time you're conceived, the guardian angel is standing by to guard you because you need protection. So the guardian angel is with you. And you need to feed your spirit. Now, I want to drop something here. If you look at a child, and how a child behaves is very different from an adult. A child has God's spirit. That spirit is a beautiful spirit. The child loves. Does he consider whether you're black or white or Chinese or Indian or Malay? Does he worry about whether you're a Christian or a Hindu or a Buddhist? A child, 1 year old or 3 months old, does he bother? If you go and say, baby, he will laugh at you. He accepts you. He's not a racist. Is a child a racist? Any baby you know is a racist in the world? Nobody. I go everywhere. I mean, I travel so much and I see babies in the trains, in the tubes, everywhere. And the baby's waving at me, smiling at me, laughing at me, all kind of things, you know, that is happening. But when I mix with adults, they're looking down, they frown, upset, they don't want to have anything to do with me because I'm a different color or different country. Why is that? Have you ever wondered why? There is no bitterness in a baby. There is no hate. No, you pinch the baby a bit, the baby cries. After they carry it, come, he'll come to you. The baby comes to you. He forgives you. There is no issue. He doesn't remember. But as the child grows older, say, yesterday you scolded me, I don't want to talk to you. When they grow older. But when the baby, you scold them, next minute they come and hug you. In fact, I remember Jasmine, when I corrected her when she was a baby, after that she'll come and give me a hug. After that correction. So is Jaden, same thing. Why are babies like that? Why are children like that? There's something different in them. But when he reaches the age of understanding, he gets his knowledge of what is right and what is wrong. He eats of the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And then what happens? I suggest to you, the spirit dies. The spirit dies. And the definition of death there is separation from God. The day you eat of the fruit, you shall die. The day you eat of the fruit, you shall die. So when he reaches that age of reasoning, and he has the knowledge of the law of good and evil, he dies. And that is separation from the author of life. That is separation from the author of life. Now you tell me, Gerald, where do you get this? And I tell you, Kenneth Hagin had Jesus Christ visit him 8 times in his lifetime. 8 times. He's been to certain places, he's been with the angels. He's passed away. He passed away about 2 years ago. Wonderful man of God. From beginning to end, everybody accepts he's a tremendous man of God. When he prayed, the dead rose. He's the kind of guy, he prays, things happen. Sick are healed. And God will tell him things that are happening in the congregation. So definitely man of God. And he says this. He says, the child, when he reaches the age of reason, when the child understands right and from wrong, he has eaten of the tree of the fruit of knowledge of good and evil, the spirit dies. And when you're born again, he says, a new spirit comes into you. And that spirit is not affected by the tree of knowledge of good and evil. That spirit is the tree of life. It gives you eternal life forever. This is what Kenneth Hagin says. Scripture, because all words must be tested with scripture. What scripture do you have to back this? Romans 7, verse 9 and 10. Paul tells us, Romans 7, verse 9 and 10. Paul tells, I was once alive apart from the law. I was once alive apart from the law. But when the commandments came, sin became alive and I died. When the commandments came, sin became alive and I died. And this commandment, which was the result in life, proved to result in death for me. Okay, that's the verse. This is what Paul is saying. I was once alive. I was alive because I didn't know the law. The child doesn't know. He just has a great time. Does the baby know what is wrong and right? Does the baby know he cannot do this, cannot do it? He doesn't. He just has a great time. Let's eat. Let's drink. Let's take the neighbor's one. Hey, I like this toy. Let's go there. Come, neighbor, can you give it to me? And the boy next day flying a kite. Come, we play together. Take the first kite. The balloon. I want the balloon. I take Jaden and Jasmine to the market when they were small. They'll grab anything. A child doesn't know that this belongs to him. This belongs to that. Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not covet this. Thou shalt not take your neighbor's goods. The child doesn't. And the child doesn't lie. You ask, where are you? The child tells you the truth. Are you hungry? Hungry. Not hungry? No. Don't like. No guile. A child is like that. But once the law came in, telling what is right and what is wrong, something dies. Something dies. And that's what Paul says. I was alive before the law came. once the law came, I died. And something happened to me. This is what Paul is saying. Something happened to me. So, you know that Jesus, God calls himself the vine, right? And we are branches connected to the vine. We cannot survive without the vine tree. So if you are separated from God, it's death. And death, that's the definition of death. Separation from God. So once the law came and you ate the tree of the fruit of knowledge of good and evil, you are separated from God. Now the important question, which you always used to answer before, but you didn't know why you answered that way. When children die, where do they go? The Bible says, unless you are born again, you shall not see the kingdom of God. But when children die, where do they go? We all say heaven. But we don't know why we say heaven. On what basis? All have sinned and fallen short. You say, all have carried the sin of Adam, isn't it? You say that. But how do children go to heaven then? Because they are not sinning. They haven't eaten the tree of knowledge of good and evil. They have not taken of that tree. They do not know. They are innocent. And they are taken to the bosom of God straight away. So any child that has been died, you know, prematurely, or child died, you know, after a year, 2 years, before reaching the age of reason. They say you reach the age of reason between 8 to 13. That's the benchmark. Goes to heaven. And there, some people who have been there say, they are kindergartens in heaven, they're taught, they're learning, they're growing. I do not know. There are some preachers, I want to say, says that the spirit is fully man at the time in which it's given to you. It is full. That means it's mature. It's able to do everything. But Canon Hagen doesn't believe that. I share the same views of Canon Hagen, that the spirit grows, because I know how I grew, and I'm growing in the spirit. The more I hear the word of God, the more I exercise the gifts that God gives, the more I do work, like ministering to the poor, helping the destitute, suddenly things are beginning to happen, getting dreams, getting visions, getting direction. The more I share the word of God, more revelation comes, because the spirit, just like the body, needs exercise. So if you exercise the spirit, you become stronger in the spirit. You exercise the body, you become stronger in the body. Very important. Okay? So vine, Jesus and God is the vine himself. We are branches. We cannot survive with it without the vine tree. When you are born again, a new spirit is put into you. Eyes are open to the gospel of grace and love of God. Born again is what? What does it mean to be born again? That I believe in Jesus Christ, isn't it? I confess with my lips and believe with my heart. Let's distill that down. What are you trying to tell us to do? Confess with our lips what? And believe in our heart what? That Jesus is Lord. That he died for my sins. And that I am cleansed forever. That is what you're supposed to believe. And you're born again. So how does the spirit tree of life come into your life? How do you eat of the fruit of the tree of life? By confessing with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believing in your heart that he has paid the price for all your sins. For all your sins. And you are saved. Nothing else. The Bible says saved. It has no longer dominion over you. The knowledge of the tree of good and evil no longer has any effect on you, because Jesus has paid the price for the effect that it had. Jesus has paid it in full. And he says, it is finished. I have done it. You are now sons and daughters of the living God. We can go. We belong now to this kingdom. We are citizens of this new kingdom. But then you tell me, Gerald, I can't see it. Prove it. Show me what's different. And Jesus said, hey, you a teacher. You are supposed to be an intelligent person. Tell me where the wind goes. Can you see the wind? Do you know where it comes from? Do you know where it goes? Don't know, right? It is like that with being born again. It is like that when your spirit dies and your spirit comes to life. It is like the wind. You can't see it, but it happens. I want to assure you, it happens. It happens, because the minute your spirit is born again, the minute you're born again, you start looking at things differently. Something begins to tell you, don't do this. Stay away from that. Don't hurt the person. Forgive the person. I can hear that. The time I'm getting angry with somebody, something is telling me forgive. Before I can get angry, it's already forgiveness. The Spirit is saying forgive. You know, before you do things in this particular way, now you have to do things in this way. If you've been a Christian long, you may have forgotten how it was before you became a Christian. But if you've been a Christian only recently, you will see that shift. Suddenly you feel, you do something, you used to do the same thing, you used to whack people all the time. No problem. Sleep nicely, have a good drink, laugh, have a good... But after you're born again, the minute you whack somebody, you feel bad. Suddenly you feel sad. Suddenly you feel, I shouldn't have whacked him. That is evidence of being born again. That is the evidence of a new spirit in you. Suddenly you change. So if you go back to the younger days, I remember we used to use bad words, we do all kinds of things in school, you know, havoc. But when you're born again, suddenly you don't want to. Something tells you, no need. Don't do this. You want to steal? No need. Don't do this. Something prevents you. And that's the Spirit of God. You begin to change. So you got the picture. You can check yourselves. Check. The best test is yourselves. You cannot see it like the wind, but it happens. It happens nevertheless in all our lives. In all our lives. Everyone, can you read? And it says very clearly here what Jesus is saying.
No man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God.
You're so beautiful. See this God, how beautiful he is to us. He made us a beautiful garden. Made us a beautiful garden. And he put the tree of life in it. And he put the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And said, don't take of it, children. Don't take of it. Because if you take of it, it will affect you. You will die. You will slowly die. It will affect you adversely. But take of the tree of life. Enjoy all that I provided for you. Such a beautiful God. But man decides, no, I want to know what's right and what's wrong. I want to take the tree of good and evil, and he eats it. And we all fall and we die. Because the law is good. But when you have knowledge, you begin to fail the law. Because Paul is very clear there is this battle going on, you know. With the good that we want to do, we do not. But the evil that we do not want to do, we do. Who shall save me? Who shall save me? But you ate of the fruit. You ate of the fruit of good and evil, and now you are in this state. And God says, listen, I will send my only Son. Because I love you, and I don't want you all to die. I want to save you. Save us from what? Save us from what? Save us from the sins, that struggle, that problem we're having, the failure that we are exercising. That's what God is saying here, so clear. He's saying, no man ascended to heaven except he that came down from heaven. So he said, I am a representative. I am Jesus Christ. I am the Son of Man who came down, and I'm declaring to you that as Moses lifted up the serpent, I must be lifted up. For whosoever believe in me, anything else? Must you do anything else apart from belief in him? Very clear. But we will say, no, let me be the ambassador and interpret and go beyond. You know, the words that Jesus says is so clear, we don't need an interpreter. Whosoever believeth in me should not perish, but have life forever. Eternal life. The converse may be true. The converse may be true too. Whosoever does not believe is already condemned. That's why it is that. Because you don't get the Spirit. So when you don't get the Spirit in you, the born-again Spirit, the new Spirit in you, you will never see the kingdom of God. And if you never see the kingdom of God, you're not going there. You're going to be going somewhere else. So no matter what you do on earth, if you don't have the Spirit of that born-again Spirit within you, you won't see. So we know that we must be connected to God in order to have eternal life. So the temple, the veil of the temple is torn. Because early on the veil was there. When Jesus died, what happened? The veil is torn. Why is the veil torn? Now I got direct access. What about my sins? It doesn't matter. If you believe in God, But nobody dare say that. How can you say that? How can you say that? But that's the word of God. The devil doesn't want you to believe that. If you're not connected with the vine, if you're not connected with God, you slowly wither away and you slowly die. You slowly die. That's what happens to mankind. To be in right standing with God, I need to believe in Jesus. That's what it means to be saved, to have eternal, to be in right standing with God. Believe in Jesus. Jesus came to die, to save you so that you do not have to die and be separated from God forever. Jesus is the life giver. He is the tree. You want to be the tree planted by the rivers of water. You don't want to be a tree planted elsewhere. You want to be planted in the vine. You want to be a branch connected to God. And how do you do that? By believing in this. Get this. The fruit of the knowledge of good and evil leads to death. No longer has effect on you. You now have the fruit of the tree of life growing in you. Remember this. I repeat. The fruit of the knowledge of good and evil that leads to death no longer has effect on you. You now have the fruit of the tree of life growing in you. The law of sin and death no longer applies to you. It is the law of grace and mercy that applies to you. Just like the law of gravity has defeated the law of aerodynamics, or should I say the other way, the law of aerodynamics has defeated the law of gravity, the law of mercy and grace has defeated the law of sin and death. And that is Jesus Christ. He has come to give you grace and mercy. He has come to save you because you believe in Him, and He will take you with Him. So you can be the prodigal son, but He will put around you a robe of righteousness. You have spent your life living a wasteful life, but God gives you the ring of authority. He gives you the shoes. He gives you the power to be part of His kingdom, to be the son and daughter of the living God, of the living God. All you got to do is trust and believe in Jesus Christ. Believe in Him as the Savior. But the devil cannot have you do this. The devil cannot let you believe this, because he is the accuser of the brethren. Because if you believe this, he's got nothing to accuse you of. Right? I got no more darts. I got no more weapons if you believe what I just told you. So the devil needs, he says, listen, use your knowledge of good and evil. I need to condemn you. I need to bring condemnation into your life. Because when you are condemned, I can generate the feeling of guilt. And when I generate the feeling of guilt, I can generate insecurity, worry, anxiousness, all these things I can generate, which results in the worldly kingdom, not the spiritual kingdom. Because when you believe in Jesus Christ and you know you are now free, you are no longer condemned. You are free to do all the things that you want to do in this life. And you will find that you do good things. Let me tell you this. You will find that the Spirit will reign when fear, condemnation, guilt is taken away from you. So the devil tells you this. Because of your failure and sin, you should not go to God. You are not worthy to enter into His presence. Go and hide yourself, Adam. Go and hide yourself. Do not come to church. Do not serve in church. Do not share the gospel. Do not show your love. Do not. You are not worthy. You have failed. You have sinned. You have lusted. You have done everything that is wrong. You are too weak. You are too young to serve God. You are too old. You are too big. You are too fat. You are too small. You are too short. The devil goes on. He says, you do not have any talent. How are you going to serve? What guitar you play is very limited. No knowledge, no gifts, no ability. You're always lusting. You're full of anger. You're full of insecurities. You're absent-minded. You're stupid. You hate. You've got a temper. And he goes on and on and on and on. But what does God tell you? You're in your weakness. my strength is made perfect. My grace is sufficient. You see the language of grace and the principles of the kingdom. But devil says, I cannot. If I were to accuse, God says, I'm trying to tell you, you are not bound by these. You are now under the law of grace and mercy. You are flying aerodynamics, but the devil only has got power in gravity. But you are flying. You're no longer bound by the laws of gravity because you are flying. But the devil cannot have that. Get this. It cannot be that the very thing Jesus came to save you from by his death on the cross is the very thing that the devil says is going to keep you from Jesus and God. You got it? It cannot be that the very thing. Now, what did Jesus come to save you from? Your sins, your failures, your weaknesses. He came to save you for that. And he died and he paid the price for it. So it cannot be that the very thing that Jesus came to save you from by his death on the cross and say it's finished is the very thing that the devil says is keeping you from God, Jesus and God. Jesus said, it's finished, I paid for it. But the devil said, no, that's keeping your sin is going to keep you from God. Your failures are going to keep you from God. Your weaknesses are keeping you from God. You cannot do the things of God. Jesus has paid for your sins. Therefore, sin can no longer keep you from God. Only you can choose. The soul can choose to tell the body, do not go to church. Do not accept. Do not believe what Jesus has done. Don't believe that he has paid the price. Believe that you have to do more. Believe that you have to work out your salvation. You have to do good works in order to succeed. Paul tells us so clearly, let this sink in. Sink into your hard drive. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. I mean, how more clearer can it get? But we don't want to accept that. You know why? Because our flesh says, let's stick to the tree of knowledge and good and evil. Why do you want to go to the tree of life? Because it feels better here. We get condemned and we get stuck here. But if you look at 2 Corinthians 5:21, so clear. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. You are the righteousness of God. That's why you can be bold as a lion. You are the righteousness of God. You can come boldly into the presence of the living God. Yvonne, can you read the next verse?
2 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God.
John 10:9.
I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved.
Amen. Can you see that? So clear. Noah's Ark, same thing. Did they have to be good to enter Noah's Ark? Did the animals have to qualify or do something? Nothing. They entered Noah's Ark and they were saved. Jesus says, I am the door. Let's go through that door. That's all you need to do. Believe in him that he is the Son of the living God and he died for your sins. Once you do that, you are born again. The Spirit takes active. Something happens within you. Something happens within you. Now, before you read Romans 8:9, I want to tell you that in Romans 7:19-22, this is what Paul says. For the good that I want, I do not do, but I practice the very evil that I do not want. But if I'm doing the very thing I do not want, I'm no longer the one doing it, but sin which dwells in me. Very strange, huh? Suddenly he's saying, listen, guys, the good that I want to do, there is something that wants to do good in you. You all feel it. We all have it. We want to do what is good, but the good that we want to do, we somehow cannot do. And the wrong things we don't want to do, we do. And what does Paul say? Therefore, it's not you who's doing it, because you are spirit. You are spirit. Something else within you is doing it. There is the virus, and sin is that virus. And that's why the new spirit you need to live eternally. The new spirit that is born again in your life. So Paul tells you this. Now let's read what Paul says after that. Romans 7.
For I joyfully concur with the law of God in the inner man.
Okay. I joyfully concur with the law of God. Where?
The inner man.
Who's the inner man? It's not the body. It's not the body because of your flesh. is warring against the spirit. But you are happy to accept God's law in the inner man then.
But I see a different law in the members of my body,
yes,
waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin which is in my members. Wretched man that I am, who will set me free from the body of this death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, on the one hand, I myself with my mind am serving the law of God, but on the other, with my flesh, the law of sin. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and as an offering for sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit.
Fantastic, isn't it? There is no longer any condemnation. He has removed condemnation from us. If you feel condemned, I want to assure you it's not from God. People call it conviction. Not true. I want to tell you it's not from God. They use different names to make you condemned. There is no longer any condemnation. That's so clear. Because with your mind you are serving the law of God, but with the other, my flesh, the law of sin. And that's why I tell you this. When your spirit, I'll drop something. I didn't read this anywhere. I didn't hear it. I want to suggest to you. When your spirit matures, the flesh and soul will comply. It's a question of just maturing your spirit. And that's why I said, what you see of yourself today, when your spirit matures, I don't know how long it takes. It depends on how much you feed it. It will. The flesh got no fight. Cannot fight already. The soul also will give in. You will find your spirit reigning. So all those senior citizens, all those men of God who grew in the spirit, different level towards the end. The example that comes to mind is Moses. You know, Moses, when he started his ministry, he threw a rod down and one snake came. Any power, even the Pharaoh's magician could do it. But when he ended his ministry, or towards the end, you know what he started doing? Opening the Red Sea, touching the ground and the earth opening up and people, 70,000 being swallowed in. I mean, unbelievable. Take Elijah. Starting all small miracles. Towards the end, calling fire anytime he wants, chariot of fire taking him up. Something happens when your spirit matures. I want you to know that you are maturing by spending time with the Word of God, by listening to the Word of God, by just hearing the Rhema Word of God. Your spirit is growing. And as you expose yourself to that, it begins to grow and grow and grow. And you don't have to worry about your body. You don't have to worry about the sin in your life. You know, there were many years that I did not share God's word the way I'm doing today. And I thought I never would in 25, 30 years, 35, 45. I never thought I would share God's word today. But suddenly it's happening. And I can't stop it. It is beyond my control because the Spirit, I want to deliver, Gerald, you share, you do, you study, you grow, and I see things and I hear things. And I know you're doing the same. So do not stop feeding the Spirit. Do not stop feeding the Spirit. Now you feed the soul. No, I want to watch my programs because I like this. Then you wonder why your spirit is not growing. That fellow is growing at snail's pace. Huh? Because you're not exposing him to the food. He's now a big, mature man. If you starve him for 3 days, then give him once a week, one meal, how is he going to grow? But every night, morning, watch that. Night, watch. Or read this, other magazines. Go to work. Do other things. How is the spirit going to grow? If you feed the body 4 times a day, some of us 5, they add supper, so, you know, don't you think you should feed the spirit 5 times a day? If it's, you say everything is parallel, and how we feed the spirit, we will talk to God. No, that's not how we feed the spirit. It is meditating on the word of God day and night. It is reading the word of God. God, tell me. And there's growth. There's growth. If you're not growing, you're dead. I mean, I shared that so many times. Anything that's not growing is dead. You see anybody here not growing? The hair stops growing or the fingernails stop growing or you're dead. Same thing with the soul. If you're not growing in your mind, you're not growing in your spirit, you're not growing in your emotions, you're not growing in your intellect, You're dead there. So you have to grow. You have to grow. So be careful what you put into your system. Put the word of God. So there is no longer any condemnation. I want you to know this. You cannot pray effectively if you feel guilty. And that's why the devil wants to condemn you. You cannot pray effectively if you feel guilty. I am divorced. I think I cannot accept God. I have failed here. I don't think. You can pray and go through the chanting. It will not happen. You cannot feel guilty. Because the Bible says there is no longer any condemnation. And in your weakness, his strength is made perfect. So if you have a weakness, thank God it is thou strength. His grace is coming through. Stand back. I'm an alcoholic. God is coming through. He will come through. I'm a drug addict. Now I've changed. God is coming through. He will come through so mightily. Even the people in the temple, the Pope or whoever you consider the highest, will stand and have to give way to you because you're functioning in God's power. You're not functioning on your own ability. Because he uses the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. He uses the weak things of the world to confound the strong. So if you got weakness, then I will boast in my weakness. Do I have a weakness? Yes, I'm fat. I need to. I'll boast and say God works in spite of my size. If I have a weakness, whatever it is, I will boast in it, Paul says, because God's strength is made perfect in my weakness. The law of spirit, what does it do to you? The Bible says so clear. The law of spirit sets you free. So the law of the spirit of the life in Christ Jesus has set you free from what? Condemnation. That's what I was trying to tell you. Free from that. The law of aerodynamics has set you free from the law of gravity. I'm no longer bound by the law of gravity. I can fly. I can fly. Nobody can stop me. Now the spirit is alive. It sees, it hears things of God. It wants to do the things of God. It wants to forgive those who hurt them. He wants to love those around. The spirit wants to be humble in you. It wants to show kindness. It wants to be gentle and faithful. It wants to exercise self-control. It wants to help the poor, the destitute, the widows. It wants to do all these things once you're born again. So when you pray in a state like that, things begin to happen. Today, Adrian Chet, he came and he prayed to help the brothers in that home, bushfire. The brothers in that home, you know, he wanted to help, to give them some music to play, to teach them. And he said, God, I want to do this. And he prayed and it came to pass. And I'm so happy God used me, but I know why I did it. Because something told me, do it. And I will bless you so much more. So I did it. I didn't ask BethEL. I didn't ask anybody. It's from me. I'm so thankful that I had the privilege and honor of hearing that voice, you know, and ministering to that prayer, which means I'm hearing the Spirit of God. You are hearing the Spirit of God. Get that. Rejoice. Rejoice. Joy to the world. Good news is here. Jesus has saved us. Jesus has saved us. The veil is torn in two. We have direct access. He has overcome the law. Get this, he is readily accepting sinners now. We can accept that through Adam, we all have failed. We all accept that. And we all accept, oh, once Adam sinned, we all sinned. The world is gone. All the bad things are happening. And we accept, we sin, we also are gone. All the bad, that one we can accept. But we find it hard to accept that with Jesus Christ, we are saved. That one, there's a reluctance. Why? The scriptures are very clear. Through one man's sin, and death. Sin and death came into the world. Just through one man's sin entered into the world, and death through sin. And so death spread to all men. That's the reason we die, because of that one man's sin. One man's righteous act and free gift came to all men, resulting in justification of life, grace, and eternal life restored. That's what we got to believe. That's what believing in Jesus Christ means. I believe he has come to save me. That's what it means to be born again. Abraham's belief in God was reckoned unto him righteousness. Your belief in Jesus Christ means you're born again. For one man's disobedience, many were made sinners. So also with one man's obedience, many will be made righteous. This word of God, I'm quoting. I'm quoting the word of God. I'm not giving you something just off the cuff. Romans 5:20, it says this. Where sin abounds, where there's so much of sin, grace abounds even more. So if somebody that has so much of sin, then God, Paul said, listen, where sin has got so much, grace is even more. The law of aerodynamics is bigger than the law of gravity. Get that into your spirits. Get that so that you can now come boldly, boldly into the presence of God and make your request known. This is how you pray. Full of faith, in boldness, with security, you stand and say, get thee behind me, Satan. You stand and say, get out. You stand and say, Goliath, do you dare challenge the armies of the living God? Do you know who you're talking to? I'm a child of the kingdom, you know. I know this God, you uncircumcised barbarian. But the rest of the army, hundreds and thousands of them, captains, skilled with war, thorough with the word of God, who knew the priest, nobody wants to say anything. Everybody is terrified because they're full of condemnation, full of guilt. But this boy was in the desert, loved God, knew God, and followed God. He was not afraid. He was not afraid. You are the righteousness of God. So when you pray boldly. You pray with authority. You pray with faith. You pray without any guilt. You pray with joy and happiness. That is what God came. That is what God wants you to do. And you will find the prayers are effective. The angel said, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the peoples. For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior. You are saved. Joy in life comes from trusting Jesus Christ, from trusting God. That's why they declare joy to the world. The good news is this. Jesus has come to save us. So if the Son of God makes you free, you will be free indeed. You are free. That's what I came to tell you. The good news is you are free today. You can pray for anything and it will happen. Because you pray boldly, without fear, without guilt. You pray without ceasing. You pray with joy, with happiness. Rejoice, Jesus has done it. The Savior has saved us. Please behave like you are saved. It is finished. The devil is beaten. Sin has been overcome. You don't have to worry about it. It is paid in full. Now you are under the law of grace and mercy. Rejoice evermore, for this is the will of God. The joy of the Lord is your strength. Remember, in your weakness, His strength is made perfect. God bless you.